Councilor Linehan?
Here.
Councilor McCarthy?
Here.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
Councilor O'Malley? Councilor Presley? Councilor Wu? Councilor Yancey? And Councilor Zakeham? Mr. President, we do have a quorum.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. I've been informed by the clerk that a quorum is present. I would ask at this time that all councilors' guests to please rise, as I will introduce today's clergy. And after the invocation is delivered, I would ask all members and guests to remain standing as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance. We have with us today a dear friend of mine, someone who's done extraordinary work in the city of Boston. He's one of those folks who brings his mission in life right to the streets of our city. We're honored to have him. Many of you know him. He's our Father Joe from St. Vinny's, Father Joe White.
Thank you. As we bring our prayers together and ask God's blessing upon our city and all that is undertaken here, ask God's blessing upon all who gather here today in council, and in congratulations and blessing to the West Roxbury Championship team, and to all the prayers we bring together. Good and gracious God, watch over our endeavors, protect the city of Boston and all who dwell in it. Intercede for us, bless our blue bays and rising hills, bless our ancient streets and historic monuments, and bless our newest arteries and ever-changing face. Within our boundaries, we ask you, Lord, to sanctify those who live and labor here and cause our works to prosper and bring happiness to all whom we love. We ask you to give us guidance. Give the council guidance to all who are called to provide leadership in this community, and grant us an honest intelligence and far-seeing wisdom. And for our city, we pray, be guided and directed, and may we always be a house of God, giving shelter to all who are troubled. And as we pass through our city, be for us a refuge, a comfort for the afflicted, and for all that we're called to bring forth goodness and grace. Watch over and protect our city, protect our nation. We pray for our military men and women, and for all who serve. And as you have been with our ancestors, so too be with us always. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Father Joe. Please stay and join us as we pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance to under God. Father Joe, could you stay for a minute? Thank you all. You can please take a seat. We're going to do a quick presentation about my dear friend, and many of you, he's your friend also, Father Joe White. Come on up here, Father. We want to recognize you today. This is a part of the council meeting where we're going to recognize next the West Roxbury High School Championship baseball team, city champs. And so for the past nearly decade, Father Joe White has served the St. Vincent's Parish in South Boston. And also in that, that includes Our Lady of Good Voyage down at the waterfront. It also includes St. Augustine's and St. Monica's, as with today's parish priest, their domain continues to expand and the work expands due to the limited amount of priests that we have in the Archdiocese. And Father Joe, I'm going to read a resolution, but Father Joe has truly been the spiritual leader of our community. Without a doubt, and there are others, he is the spiritual leader in South Boston. And he's taken us through some very trying times and has supported us in many, many ways. And his ministry is doing good for those who can't even help themselves. So, resolution of the Boston City Council by the President and Councilor-at-Large Michael Flaherty and all the members of the Boston City Council. Whereas the Boston City Council extends their thank you and gratitude to Father Joe White for his many years of service to the South Boston community. And whereas, known by many as Father Joe, Father has positively impacted generations of South Boston residents with his spiritual guidance. Father Joe is a local legend, having grown up in Savin Hill, being ordained to the priesthood on June 22, 1991, and has served the last 10 years, as I said, as the pastor of St. Vinny's and Our Lady of Good Voyage. Whereas Father Joe White has been a valuable member to our community in shaping our youth, providing spiritual guidance to many, as well as being instrumental in providing support to people in recovery. Father Joe believes one of the most important things we can do in our lives is to help our youth develop in a positive and confident way. And he lives this way day to day, helping both girls and boys, South Boston, in South Boston, and families around the city who are impacted by the scourge of substance abuse and addiction. Be it resolved that the Boston City Council in meeting assembled does here wholeheartedly thank Father Joe White for his many years of dedication and commitment to South Boston and wish him well in his new assignment as Director of Recovery Services for the Archdiocese of Boston. Let's give Father Joe a big hand. He said no twice to speaking. I said, oh, wow, that's the first time anybody shut him up. Now, Father Joe, please.
Thank you, Bill, and to all of you who have supported efforts that were just mentioned. Without all of you and without the good people in the community, not much can be done. So thank you. Southie actually put me on the map and in connecting with that. And I'm very grateful. I'm sad to be leaving Southie, but I'm also glad to be able to say I am now your pastor, as I am at St. Joseph's Church next door here off of Staniford Street, but coming together. Thank you very much for everyone who has connected with anything I've been involved with in ministry, because it's all the good people and their goodness. And thank you, Bill.
All right. Thank you, Father. Why don't we come on? Yeah, so Father Joe's going to be at St. Joseph's. That's Father Joe, St. Joseph's. And it's right over in Staniford Street. And the church has not really been open. So he'll be expecting all of us at services. Come on, Murph. You're the big guy. You can always stand him back.
Shit, his first person I prayed for in here was his wife.
Still needs those prayers.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
All right, give it up one more time for Father Joe. At this time, I'd like to ask Councilor O'Malley to please come forward to the podium while he introduces the next presentation.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to invite our 2015 city baseball champion, West Roxbury High School athletes and their coaches to join me, please. As you will soon see and hear, this is a remarkable group of young scholar athletes, one of whom was coached by our own Tim McCarthy in his Little League career, so Tim gets partial credit for their great win as well. We're going to hear from Coach Cliff Wilson and the two co-captains shortly, but I just wanted to take an opportunity to recognize this great group of young men. This is, many of you know what was known as West Roxbury High School. It was always one high school, and then in the early 2000s, it became four smaller schools, and then was condensed to two smaller schools, West Roxbury Academy and the Urban Science Academy. As such, these are students in both schools that work together as one team, and we were all sort of hindered this winter, our spring sports, with the fact that there was so much snow on the ground well into April that it was difficult for students to practice. This group, what's more remarkable is the fact that for the last 2 years they did not have a field. The field next to West Roxbury, the former West Roxbury High School, the West Roxbury Education Complex, is part of Phase 2 of Millennium Park, a great new endeavor that this body helped pass 2 years ago, and in September it will be open. It'll be state-of-the-art, incredible. But for 2 years, these guys didn't have that opportunity. So the council president asked as we were coming in, where do they play home games? And every home game would be played on another field. So if they were playing English, it might be English's home or my home field advantage, or it might be our home field advantage. But regardless, they didn't have a field, yet they still won. This team won under the direction of Coach Cliff Wilson and assistant coach Christian Ortiz. The final game was against Latin Academy, where the West Roxbury High won by 2-1. And there are three seniors on this team, one of whom is with us. We'll be playing ball at Fitchburg State next year, but it's a young team. So the die has been cast, and we have high hopes that we'll see them back here next year. Coach Wilson described what sets this team apart. Not only do they have a love of baseball and a commitment to the sport, they also feel a strong loyalty and accountability to one another. He said they are a family who do not want to let each other down. For the past 2 years, as I said, the team's been without a home. They would literally practice in the hallways or in the gym. It was very difficult. And we know that it'll be incredible when the new field opens in September, but it really just shows a remarkable group of young athletes, scholar athletes, I might add. Making sure that they had passing grades, strong grades was a key component. And before we all come up to take a picture, we have a resolution, which I will just briefly surmise. It says, on behalf of all of us, the entire city council, we extend our congratulations to the West Roxbury High School varsity baseball team in recognition of their victory in the 2015 Boston City League Championship and for their commitment to teamwork and good sportsmanship. Congratulations, gentlemen.
Thank you, Councilman O'Malley. It is a, excuse me. It's a pleasure to be here, to be honored like this by this special group of people. We as a team have persevered, and I think that's the word that probably, perhaps is the best word to use. We went through a lot of difficult times with conditions of fields, lack of fields, but it just demonstrated to me as a coach that hard work, dedication, commitment, these are all words we use, accountability with each other and about each other, paid dividends. And those dividends were us being able to be involved in and eventually winning the city championship. And I couldn't be prouder of this group of boys. I couldn't be prouder of our school. I couldn't be proud of the support that we've received all around the city, and particularly today, thank you so much for allowing us to be here and recognizing the achievement that this group of young men has accomplished. Thank you.
Here from our two, we'll all come up for a picture.
My name is Estrus Rojas, and I'm a junior, and I graduate in 2016.
My name is Vianchi Pujols. I'm a senior, and I graduated yesterday, class 2015.
And where are you going next year?
I'll be attending Fitchburg State University.
Paparazzi, huh? Guys, thank you. No, you keep that. That's for you guys. Good luck. Stay in touch.
I'm a good friend of mine. Good man. Listen to him. He knows his stuff. He has to compete quickly with him.
Congratulations. Absolutely. See you next year.
Thank you so much.
No, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Jim.
Let that be light.
All right, congratulations once again to the West Roxbury baseball team, who are now the 2015 city championships. Champions. All right. If there are no corrections to be made, the minutes of the last meeting will stand approved. Seeing, hearing no objections, the minutes are so approved. Madam Clerk. Yeah, and could you please recognize that both Councilor Presley and Councilor Yancey are present, Madam Clerk?
Thank you, Mr. President.
And after that, we'll do communications from His Honor the Mayor, please.
Docket number 1025, message in order, authorizing the Office of Youth Engagement and Employment to accept and expend a grant of $764,561 from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for the purpose of supporting summer jobs for youth work, a program for at-risk youth.
A docket 1025 will be assigned to the Committee on Healthy Women, Families, and Communities.
Docket number 1026, message and order authorizing the Office of Youth Engagement and Employment to accept and expend funds in an amount not to exceed $500,000 from individuals, organizations, local and private businesses for the purpose of supporting year-round youth employment.
Docket 1026 will be assigned to the Committee on Healthy Women, Families, and Communities.
Docket number 1027, message and order declaring surplus land located at 115 Federal Street, Ward 3, parcel number 0422-5000, to transfer the care, custody, management, and control of said property to the Public Facilities Commission.
Docket 1027 will be assigned to the Committee on Economic Development, Planning, and Labor.
Docket number 1028, message and order authorizing the Police Commissioner to accept and expend $30,000 in award funding under the FY15 Law Enforcement Equipment Grant funded by the Executive Office of Public Safety and Security under the Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistant Grant for the purpose of purchasing printers to be installed in cruises as part of the DDACTS Crime and Traffic Safety Program Pilot Project.
Councilor Murphy moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1028. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1028 has passed.
Docket number 1029, message in order to declare surplus a garbage truck, which is no longer needed by the Boston Public Works Department, and to transfer ownership of the garbage truck to the Dorchester House Multi-Service Center, Inc., for the purpose of transferring it to the city of Cap-Haitien, Haiti, to aid in the country's rebuilding.
Councilor McCarthy moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1029. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1029 has passed.
Docket number 1030, message and order authorizing the police department to accept and expend a donation of $1,000 from the Pat Rogers Fund for the use by the Boston Police Peer Support Unit in its work to prevent suicide.
Councilor Murphy moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1030. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1030 has passed.
Docket number 1031, message and order authorizing the police department to accept and expend a donation of office furniture from the Furniture Trust for use by the Crimes Against Children Unit, known as CACU.
Councilor Murphy moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1031. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1031 has passed.
Docket number 1032, message and order authorizing the police department to accept a donation of a 2004 Honda Accord from the National Insurance Crime Bureau for use by the Auto Theft Unit to conduct auto theft and insurance fraud investigations.
Councilor Murphy moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1032. All in favor say aye. All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1032 has passed.
Docket number 1033. Message and order authorizing the Environment Department to accept and expend a grant of $28,500 awarded by the National Park Services passed through the Massachusetts Historical Commission for the FY15 survey and planning.
Councilor O'Malley, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Mass Historic Commission Survey and Planning Grant Program provides federally funded, reimbursable 50-50 matching grants to support historic preservation, planning activities, in communities throughout the state. Several years ago, in Councilor LaMartina's district, the North End Phase 1 of this survey was completed in 2014. 120 buildings were along the periphery of the neighborhood were documented. Phase 2 of the survey is in progress and will result in new or updated inventory forms for 130 properties. And then Phase 3, which will be the final phase, that is what this grant will go towards, given the fact that it will hire a consultant, continue all the data collected, given the fact that it's under $30,000 and it's part of a program that's already ongoing. I move for suspension and passage. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor O'Malley. Councilor O'Malley moves suspension of the rules and passage of Docket 1033. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1033 has passed. Madam Clerk, reports of public officers and others, please.
Docket number 1034, the constable bonds of Shane Reed, Joseph Turco, Cavkill Bromfield, and Samuel Drozier, having been duly approved by the collector treasurer, were received and approved.
Docket 1034, which has been received under the usual terms and agreement, all those in favor say aye. All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1034 is approved under the usual terms and agreement. Conditions. Terms and conditions. Thank you. Madam Clerk, reports of committee.
Docket number 0830. The Committee on Government Operations, to which was referred on May 6, 2015, docket number 0830, a petition for a special law regarding an act concerning the retirement classification for the Boston School Police Officers, submits a report recommending the order ought to pass.
Chair recognizes the chair of the Committee on Government Operations, Councilor Flaherty, on docket 0830.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is a home rule petition that would adjust the retirement classification for Boston School Police Officers from Group 1 to Group 2. We held a hearing on May 27th and heard from members of the Retirement Board, school police, and also the Boston Superior Officers Federation, who described the responsibilities and challenges of school police officers when working to keep our schools safe every day. These officers are unarmed and are first responders for sometimes some of the most violent incidents that occur both during school and at extracurricular and athletic events in our city. Group 2 classification includes public safety and law enforcement employees, which would be more appropriate for school police to be in rather than their current classification, which is Group 1, which consists of clerical and administrative workers. The testimony that was offered explained the cost impact would be minimal because the membership size is very small, currently 75 officers, with the average age of the officers and the number of years on the job de minimis. At this time, I recommend that this ought to pass and would defer at this point to the lead sponsor, our colleague, City Councilor Frank Baker, for further comment. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Flaherty. Councilor Baker.
President, and thank you, Mr. Chair. So the difference between group one and group two is the ability to retire 5 years earlier at 60. The police officers and firefighters now, they're in group four, so they can retire at 55. This is not group four. This is group two. There are currently 71 officers in the Boston School Police. Only 7 of them are eligible to retire in the next 7 years. All others are more than 10 years away from retirement. And based on the calculations proposed, the proposed change in the group status from 1 to 2 would increase July 1st, 2016, normal cost by only $56,000. Based on 9 years remaining in the funding schedule, the fiscal 2017 appropriations would increase by $216,000. Now, this petition was approved by the retirement board, I want to say 10 years ago or so, and was denied by the previous administration. I think we're just trying to right a wrong that had happened years ago. And I ask you, my colleagues, for a vote in the affirmative on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Baker. Councilor Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. President. As the chair of the Committee on Public Safety, I just want to acknowledge the fact that the Boston School Police are a public safety agency. And they were miscast into Group 1 originally, and this is just righting a wrong and putting them where they belong. So I fully support the efforts of Councilor Baker and the Chair, Michael Flaherty, to make a public safety agency get a public safety designation in their retirement. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Murphy. Councilor Flaherty moves acceptance of the committee report and passage of docket 0830. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Docket 0830 has passed. Madam Clerk, matters recently heard for possible action.
Docket number.
You read docket 0111 and 0112 together,
thank
please.
Thank you, Mr. President. Docket number 0111. Message and order approving a petition for a special law regarding an act relative to certain affordable housing at Orion Heights Public Housing Project in the City of Boston. Docket number 0112. Message and order approving a petition for a special law regarding an act relative to certain affordable housing, Whittier Public Housing Project in the City of Boston.
Chair recognizes the Chair of the Committee on Government Operations, Councilor Flaherty.
Thank you, Mr. President. Docket 0111 and Docket 0112 are home rule petitions relative to affordable housing development sponsored by Mayor Walsh. These home rule petitions would allow the BHA to move more quickly and efficiently to redevelopment Orion Heights in Councilor Lamantina's district in East Boston, as well as Whittier Housing Development in Councilor Jackson's district, by allowing certain exemptions from the state's contract and procurement laws. We held a hearing on Monday with representatives from the BHA who explained the need for these laws to streamline the sub-bid process and maintain a cost-effective plan for immediate renovations. Similar legislation has been filed in the past to allow for redevelopment of Bromley Heath, Mission Main, Orchard Gardens, Maverick Gardens, West Broadway Development, Old Colony, Washington Beach, and Franklin Hill Housing Development. So these are very similar, if not the exact same, mechanisms that they're using to make these necessary renovations. With passages of docket 0111 and docket 0112, the BHA can most efficiently begin its process for revitalization of both housing developments, resulting in full replacement of the 331 existing apartments at Orion Heights and full replacement of the 200 apartments at Whittier. So at this time, I'm recommending that both of these dockets sponsored by Mayor Walsh ought to pass. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Flaherty. Councilor Yancey.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. A scheduling conflict did not allow me to participate in the hearing on Monday. This is a very important issue, Mr. President. Back in 2010, when we were debating an identical proposal for Franklin Hill, I raised some concerns about the privatization of BHA housing. And an upshot of those debates and discussions was a commitment from the then administrator of the BHA that they will no longer pursue this particular approach, where the Boston Housing Authority will continue to own the land, but the units will be privately owned. In the case of Franklin Hill, it not only privatized the housing units, but also reduced the number of affordable units at that location. So because of that reason, philosophically, I don't believe we should be encouraging the privatization of BHA housing units. I will not be supporting either of these two. No reflection on the district city councilors, who I have enormous love, respect, and admiration for. But the issue of privatizing BHA housing, I think, is a very significant public policy issue facing the city of Boston. And it does open the door for even some gentrification in certain areas, as well as possible displacement. In spite of all the assurances, in the case of Franklin Hill, the vast majority of the tenants who used to live there no longer live there. Much of that was by choice, but long term, the Franklin Hill housing development has been privatized and will continue to be so, albeit the land itself will continue to be owned by the BHA. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Yancey. Councilor Jackson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I rise to support this matter. The reason Whittier Street is actually in my district. Whittier Street, so folks know, is up for one of the federal choice neighborhoods grants. And this would actually allow for that process to move forward. I actually agree with Councilor Yancey on, in Franklin Hill, they actually lost units. The good aspect of the Choice Neighborhoods grant is that they actually won't be able to receive receive the funding unless there's a one-for-one replacement. The Whittier Street housing development is right across the street from one of the newest Northeastern buildings. And you see across the street disparity in terms of lack of investment from BHA versus what has happened on the Northeastern side of the street. This is a neighborhood that has stood through some of the most difficult times and deserves to have investment dollars flow. What we did press BHA on is, what type of leverage do we have? Can we get more than a one-for-one? Because we know in the city of Boston right now, we're losing affordable housing to expiring use in all of our districts faster than we can actually build it. And so the question is, are we able to leverage more than a one-for-one in situations like this? We are told that there is a possibility that that could happen. But I think what's most critical is that the people who still live in that facility have first right of refusal to any of those units. They've been through really, really tough times. And as the neighborhood and the community around them rises, they should be part of that rising class and part of that wave that is definitely cresting for people in Roxbury and other neighborhoods in the city. So I will be supporting this as it goes forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilor Jackson. Councilor LaMattina.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to echo remarks by Councilor Jackson. The Orient Heights development is in my backyard. So if you know where I live in East Boston, it's in my backyard. It's deplorable conditions. It's replacement one-on-one. It's adding more affordable housing. It's a good thing. I saw it happen at Maverick Development. I worked at Maverick Development as a youth worker, and I see the big difference over there. BHA just does not have the resources anymore to manage a lot of their properties. Had a lot of issues the last couple of summers at Orient Heights because of the lack of management at that location. I support this. The people that live in Orient Heights deserve to live in better conditions. So thank you. And I urge you all to vote for this. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor LaMartina. Councilor McCarthy?
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I also rise to support this. And I can tell you firsthand in District 5, Beet Street development in Rosendale has been reconstructed. Crime rate is down. Pride is up. It's a wonderful little community that they've built in there. So hopefully the next time I stand, I'm supporting a Fairmount redo as well. So I'm voting in the affirmative.
Thank you, Councilor McCarthy. Councilor Zakin.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just have one question, if I could ask through you to Councilor Flaherty. This would still maintain these properties as permanently city-owned land, BHA-owned land, just under a different management structure, and this would still be permanently affordable. Those are the two questions that I could ask through you, Mr. President.
Councilor Flaherty?
They will retain the land. It's almost sort of like a sale-leaseback situation where they're going to retain the land at all times, and then it's going to be a private company who will come in and manage the property. So we're not, the BHA is not ceding any of their portfolio.
The second part, I'm sorry, again through you, Mr. President, that these will still be permanently affordable units?
Yes. Yes, and also, yes, the question, the short answer is yes to the affordability. There's also Section 8 vouchers available to all existing residents because there'll be a displacement through the renovations, and they're given the option of either retaining the Section 8 voucher and moving into a permanent residence in the neighborhood, or bringing that voucher back and coming back into a newly renovated building in the community that they've been living in. So there's a pretty good alternative option for existing residents. They could either slide out for a little while and then come back under new and better living conditions, or they may be able to take that voucher anywhere they want to sustain themselves and their family. So I think it's a win-win for the tenant. Thank you.
Thank you both. On docket 111, Councilor Flaherty moves acceptance of the committee report and passage of docket 0111. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 0111 has passed. Councilor Flaherty moves acceptance of the committee report and passage of docket 0112. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 0112 has passed. Councilor Yancey.
I just request to be recorded in a negative on the previous two dockets.
Yep. Madam Clerk, would you please record Councilor Yancey as in the negative in the past two dockets, 0111 and 0112. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Madam Clerk, if you could read docket 066, 263, and 64.
Docket number 0662, message and order for annual appropriation and tax order for FY 2016. Docket number 0663, message and order for annual appropriation for the school department for the FY 2016. And docket number 0664, message and order approving an appropriation of $40 million in the other post-employment benefits known as OPEB, Liability Trust Fund, established under Section 20 of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 32B.
Chair recognizes Councilor Siomo, the chair of our Ways and Means.
Thank you, Mr. President. First, let me thank all of the councilors for their thoughtful and thorough participation to date on the operating budget as well as the OPEB docket. The operating budget is made up of two dockets, 0662 and 0663. One is the departmental operating budget. The other is the budget for the school department, which is around $1 billion this year. And docket 0664 is the city's contribution to the OPEB or other post-employment benefit trust fund that we established many years ago to mitigate the almost or over $2 billion liability that the city currently has. In accordance with Chapter 190, Section 15 of the Acts of 1982, this body must take action on these dockets today, or they will become effective automatically. To date, the committee has held 28 hearings on the FY16 budget, comprising over 64 hours of deliberation and months of planning. Additionally, the committee has been distributing for review written testimony from all the departments that have not had budget hearings. At this time, I recommend that dockets 0662, 0663, and 0664 be rejected without prejudice to allow for more time to review recently submitted departmental written testimony and in advance of an expected resubmission that will reflect the updated budget priorities. Thank you, Mr. President.
Councilor Schiavo. Thank you. Councilor Jackson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I rise to bring up a couple of issues in the budget. I think in looking towards the summer and aggressive violence prevention programs, $9.6 million of a city funding would actually get all of the young people who are waiting for a job, as well as those who will not receive a job, an actual summer job, and an additional 1,000 year-round jobs. In addition, when I was young, the program started at age 14 and went to age 19. There's some work that we should do there. In addition, I think many of us heard loud and clear in the education hearings, supervisors of attendance are needed, and we should restore those individuals to their jobs. There's currently only four, and a case log of 1,400 to date for this year of folks who, young people who haven't gone to school for 60 days. We have to do better, and understanding that the statute is actually 8 days a quarter, so we're well above that, and we've basically triaged, and we had Judge Craven in here to let us know about ourselves when it came to that. I think a couple of other areas that we need to look at. It was amazing to see those young men from West Roxbury High come in. And great that the field had been done over, but horrible that the school department was going to close their school. So the adversity that they went through on the field, to me, it pales in comparison to someone putting on record that they would close their school and not even have a plan for that building. It is imperative that the actual facilities plan process start. We gave them the money last year. Let's get it going. This is an 18-month process. We could have been 12 months into the 18-month process had it moved forward. It is unfair to the young people. And I heard Councilor Malley mention words like loyalty and accountability. Well, we need to be loyal to our young people, and we need to be accountable to them and not put forward closures outside of an actual plan. And I think all of the folks in this room have demanded that. And we're now a year down the road from since we allocated that money, and it hasn't moved forward. In addition to that, we have schools that were that are inclusion model schools, which means that they're going to serve students who have special education needs. Where we've shifted schools, you know, it's an inclusion model school, and you move into a building that doesn't have an elevator. And then you spend money on building an elevator in a school that doesn't fit the needs of the young people. Absolutely critical that we roll our sleeves up and do the right thing relative to the young people. Lastly, the definition of poverty in the Boston Public School budget has adversely affected many of the schools relative to their budgeting based on the school lunch program, which now we actually don't have a way to discern where those funds should go and how they should get allocated. And so many of the schools are actually losing funding based on the new allocation. A lot of work that we have to do. I want to compliment the chair. We've spent a lot more time together than with our families. Some of the most important work that we'll do, I believe, is in this budget process, and in particular for the education budget. And I want to applaud the chair for the diligence and the just really good work him, as well as his office, has done in doing this. And I also want to give compliments to my office also for the work that they've done. We still have work to do, and I look forward to rolling our sleeves up and doing that work.
Thank you, Councilor Jackson. Councilor Yancey.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I rise to support the work of the chair of the Ways and Means Committee. I think he's been working very hard and diligently, and he's been very conscientious. So I want to support, of course, the rejecting without prejudice. However, Mr. President, I still have some abiding concerns about the operation of city government that can be significantly impacted by some revisions in the budget when it is resubmitted by the administration. Mr. President, I do not support taking additional children off of the Boston Public School buses. Actually, I think that the eighth graders and the seventh graders should have the opportunity for a safer and more reliable trip to and from school. Secondly, Mr. President, this budget does not acknowledge the fact that many community centers were shut down by the previous administration, and there's no effort in this budget to reopen any of those community centers. I'm specifically referring to the Marshall Community Center, but there are more than a half dozen others as well. Mr. President, we have an obligation to do what we can to make our city safer, and to do what we can to encourage a positive environment for all residents, children as well as adults. And by failing to reopen the Marshall Community Center and some of the others, we're missing that opportunity. Thirdly, Mr. President, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me that a city which serves 57,000 students has only five truant officers. It makes even less sense to me that those five truant officers are going down to one for 57,000 students. Now, we were told that our teachers, our administrators, and other staff will pick up the slack and make sure that all of our students who are supposed to be in school are, in fact, there. But I'm not persuaded by those arguments. The other concern I have is while we're making some positive steps in the right direction with regards to street workers and mentors, the steps are far too modest and far too timid. And I know that we're working in partnership with nonprofits, et cetera, and that's fine. But if we're serious about reaching out to young people, and while the numbers are down, the average of 700 to 800 young people drop out of school every year. And the question I raise every year is, who's following up on those individuals? That's not even a job for our truant officers. So I believe that we should significantly increase the number of street workers. And I will also say that we can do a better job in terms of the city accepting financial responsibility for hiring more youth, expand the youth jobs program. I think it's one of the best investments we can make, and a $9.6 million investment and a close to a $3 billion budget is not all that significant. I will close by noting that in our capital budget, we still have no dollars to build a new high school on the grounds of the Boston State Hospital site. It's the only place in the city that we have 14 acres of land fully accessible. We can create a college campus-like environment right next to a biologic lab, a nature center, new housing. It's centrally located. This body has approved appropriation, the capital appropriation for this in the past. We have the opportunity to do it again. I just ask that the administration realize that none of our high school buildings are getting any younger. None of those buildings are state-of-the-art in terms of technology for the 21st century. And we have upwards of 5,000 Boston Public High School students attending non-high school facilities. And they're competing with the children in suburban areas who take new schools for granted and state-of-the-art technology for granted. Why are we punishing our children? So with those caveats, Mr. President, I'm going to support the recommendation of the chair of the Ways and Means Committee.
Thank you, Councilor Yancey. Councilor Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, let me congratulate the chairman, Moxiomo, and his staff and our central staff on the job that they've done to date presenting and reviewing the fiscal budget of 2016. I just wanted to pick up on a couple of points that have been made. This is kind of institutional memory. I hope I don't show my age, but 1999, City Councilor Peggy Davis Mullen talked about increasing the number of truant officers from 10 to 15. Since then, we've gone from 10 to 4. And one of the big arguments we made at the time, 16 years ago, was that under state law, only an attendance officer can approach students off of a student's campus, off of a school's campus or property, during school hours, unless there's probable cause that those students would be involved in committing a crime. So a Boston police officer does not have the authority to approach kids, an MBTA police officer, a Boston school police officer. Only under mass law does a duly sworn attendance officer have the right to approach students if they're not on. And that's why it's important for us to get up and look at the declining enrollment here as we reject this budget, hopefully, and say, hey, we've got to bulk that up because we're failing students by failing them day to day. The other point I'd like to bring up is, and this is historical as well, in 2001, the prior administration tried to privatize custodial services in the Boston public schools. And on a particular Wednesday in June, back in 2001, our council president, Jimmy Kelly, Councilor Feeney, and I, and the members of the council, went to the Eagle Room and met with the mayor at the time and held up the budget. And something similar could be happening over there now with the basis school administrators who have been seeing declining roles. They're a union, they're an administrative union, over the last several years, culminating this year in this 260 basis employees. And just recently, they got 64 of them got pink slipped. So it's like 27% of the bargaining unit is pink slipped. And what has happened over the course of the years routinely at the school department is these folks who are union folks who supposedly have union protections get pink slipped and their jobs get eliminated. And then 3 months later, they come back in a reclassified, the jobs are put back under a reclassification for management. And the school department lets those folks go and then hires who they want. That, to me, is privatization. And I don't believe the mayor that I know that leads this city today would ever have a part, knowing his background and his love and his experience prior to becoming mayor, would ever have a party to this. So I'm supporting the chair in rejecting this budget, looking forward to adding attendance offices, and looking forward to stopping privatization in the Boston School Department because it's the right thing to do. Any one of us in 2001 who had voted to privatize custodians would have had that blemish on their record moving forward for the rest of their days in public office. The same thing I can say to all of you. If we allow that to go forward at this time, shame on us. I support the chair, his hard work. I look forward to rejecting without prejudice this year's budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Murphy. Councilor Presley.
Thank you, Mr. President. I too want to commend and thank our chair who's been leading this long walk. Thanks central staff and the chairman's staff as well. I too support his recommendation. You know, there are some very important investments in this budget despite cuts at the federal and state level. I'm really encouraged by the return and restoration of the cadet program in the Boston Police Department and the creation of the diversity recruitment officer in the Boston Fire Department as a means towards diversifying both. It's also very encouraging to have a mayor that not only talks about trauma, but wants to make the formidable investments necessary to treat it, and is also committed to addressing trauma in all its forms with the investments that we've seen through the Boston Public Health Commission and through the Boston Police Department around anti-human trafficking efforts. However, there are areas that require an even greater investment in order to build a healthy community in every neighborhood of the city. I want to join the clarion call along with my colleagues to fight for the push to save our truancy officers within our Boston Public Schools, knowing the role that they play in dropout prevention and identifying those youth that may be in homes where they are being abused or neglected or experiencing trauma, and helping to reduce the school-to-prison pipeline and so many other important roles that they play. So it's necessary that we not punish them for the success that we've seen in the dropout numbers going down and then pull away those investments that were critical to the dropout numbers decreasing. So we should protect those four truancy officers. Also, you know, the challenges faced by our young people and the unrest that we see throughout the country really is the direct result of failed policy, divestment, and inequitable access to resources. Now, Boston really has done a great job in maintaining the youth fund, but we can and should do better and must have a plan to increase the number of youth jobs paid for by the city while managing the projected increase in the minimum wage. What I'd like to suggest is a three-year plan that will increase the total number of summer jobs and year-round jobs incrementally until we reach the goal of 5,000 summer and 1,000 year-round jobs. Again, that's a three-year plan. In addition, an issue that I've been banging the drum on for several years and in partnership with the chair of the Education Committee, I remain concerned about the projected cuts to our school food program and their impact on food that is already lacking in palatability and meaningful nutrition and resulting in great waste within our public schools. I'm asking for an operations assessment and the retention of staff until the new superintendent can review the entire process. 50% of our schools have kitchens, 50% of them don't. I would like for us to pursue a feasibility study as to whether or not we should return to a central kitchen that would be locally sourced. So I'm asking for an operations assessment and the retention of staff until the new superintendent can review the entire school district system. I also just want to remind you know, all of us, and we've heard this throughout the budget hearings the last couple of days, you know, we've said that we want Madison Park High School to be a state-of-the-art vocational technical learning institution, and we need to continue to keep our eyes on the prize and honor the verbal pledges that we've made to those young people. They deserve it. What has happened there for all these years is really criminal. And so beyond the verbal pledges that we've made, that we honor those pledges with considerable long-term investments in order to see that ship righted. And finally, I want to talk about Long Island. You know, as we consider long-term investments in both capital funds to rebuild a bridge and the potential operating costs of the island, I really hope we can have a comprehensive and collaborative conversation about the island's future use. To date, it really remains unclear what the overarching plan is for the currently displaced guests and how we improve our homeless and substance abuse services. There really needs to be a plan before the city authorizes replacing a bridge. Furthermore, I think our limited resources are best directed towards housing first. And I support a request for implementing a city voucher program for affordable housing units for homeless individuals. This budget certainly makes clear investments in Boston's neighborhoods, and I really do commend our mayor for that. However, there are critical gaps in this budget that are critical to ensuring that each neighborhood has an ability to build healthy, safe, and thriving communities. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Presley. Councilor Wu.
Thank you, Mr. President. I wanted to commend and thank our Chairman of Ways and Means, Councilor Siomo, for all the work he's put in, and all the other chairs who have co-piloted the process, chief among them, Councilor Jackson, with the school department budget. It's been a long and informative session, and I see a lot of exciting things in the budget around investments in affordable housing, open space, education, particularly to see permitting and licensing focused on throughout every department's presentation and how the city's thinking about streamlining access and increasing access to technology and therefore city services across the board that way. We've had many, many constituent meetings as well in this process. I did want to rise and echo the remarks by many other councillors up until this point and recognize that members of the Youth Justice and Power Union are with us. They were passionate, they were respectful. I wanted to publicly support their request for the $9.6 million for youth jobs and extending the age range 14 to 19 for eligibility. Investing in our youth is well worth it for the city's future. So looking forward to continued negotiations and conversations about the budget, but wanted to quickly summarize my thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Wu. I have lights flashing of folks who already had an opportunity to speak. I'm going to go on with other councilors first and give them an opportunity to speak prior to that. And I gave everybody ample time to date to speak. Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to thank the Chair of Ways and Means, Council Siomo, and I trust that Council Jackson, that time was quality time spent with Council Siomo. I just want to echo a lot of the comments of the previous speakers around the school department, mostly, especially Councilor Murphy, where we talk about privatization. I was a victim of privatization 4 years ago. There's people at the school department that are in their long-term jobs. I had my job for almost 25 years when I was laid off. It's a pretty difficult situation to be in. There's people that I worked with at the print department that's still out of work today. I think I would like to see out of the school department their plan calls for the number was 130 layoffs, but they say it's going to be less than that. I would like to see that plan, who the people are, where they work, what their jobs, what is the plan with it. After that, we all talked about the truancy offices, but there's the men in the in the distribution center, there's SPED liaisons, there's quite a few positions over there that I'd like to get clarification on. But thank you for your time.
Thank you, Councilor Baker. Councilor O'Malley.
Thank you, Mr. President. A lot has been said in words far more eloquent than my own, so I will be mercifully brief. I want to begin by thanking the chairman and our good friend from Alston Brighton, Councilor Siomo, on his work, as well as central staff, as well as the mayor's staff. Dave Sweeney has been incredibly helpful and attentive to me. I share a lot of the concerns. At the outset, I want to say I think this is a good budget. Clearly, there is some room for improvement. There's always room for improvement everywhere we look. So on a couple of matters, certainly the truancy funding, protecting those positions, the youth summer jobs to allow for that 5,000 goal within a couple of years, I think is paramount. These are two issues that investment now is not only good policy, but is financially responsible for the future with these opportunities that we can save and not save, the opportunities we can offer to young people. So I add my voice to that chorus. Similarly, Councilor Presley mentioned the voucher system for Section 8 travel vouchers. This is a program that Washington, D.C. has done. I think there's a lot of merit in it, and I think it's something that we ought to be exploring going forward. Finally, I am incredibly grateful for some of the capital improvements in District 6, specifically two I want to highlight, the library, and I do want to thank Amy Ryan for her leadership on that position. And secondly, the West, we mentioned it earlier today, the West Roxbury Educational Complex, that new field which will be open. These are good things, but I think there's a couple of other opportunities where we can hopefully work together and will therefore be heeding the chairman's call for rejection without prejudice and look forward to the 2 weeks ahead as we continue this work. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor O'Malley. Councilor Yancey.
Thank you. I'll be brief, Mr. President. I rise because my good colleague at large, Councilor Murphy, was recounting something that took place in 2001. You mentioned that Councilor Kelly was president at the time. Well, history can't be changed. I was president in 2001. But he is correct in everything else he mentioned. What the city council did that year, I think, is worth noting. And that is we fought against the privatization of custodians, and we were successful. We also fought to add funds to our housing programs, and we were successful. But we also fought to augment the Boston City Council staff, and we were successful. We added an assistant budget director position, and we added a legislative director slash council to the council position. And that's occupied very ably today by Christine O'Donnell. So I had to correct the record. I'm sure my colleague doesn't mind being reminded who was president in 2001. That's right. His was the deciding vote, along with six others who made me president. Storekeepers within the school department must be retained. They're part of the group that's designated to be cut, and their positions are going to be privatized. And Councilor Baker knows that I fought against the privatization of the graphic arts department without success, but we did put up a good fight. I also take this opportunity, Mr. President, to ask that the administration consider adding funds to ensure that every Boston Police Department vehicle is equipped with an automatic electronic defibrillator. We have many cases where it takes more than 6 or 7 minutes before our emergency medical technicians can arrive on the scene of a cardiac arrest or similar emergency, but we have pervasive presence of our police vehicles, and we should not miss that opportunity to save lives. So I'm asking the administration to work with this council to ensure that all of our public safety vehicles have AEDs. Obviously, our EMS vehicles have them. Obviously, our fire department vehicles have them. But we have more police out in the public than any other public vehicle. And I think it makes sense, if we're serious about saving lives, to make that investment as well. I also am advocating the use of these AEDs in all public buildings and encourage the use in all private buildings as well. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Yancey. Councilor Jackson.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I just wanted to add a couple of areas that I missed. I, too, believe that we need to be aggressive in our housing voucher program, and in particular for those folks who are displaced off of Long Island. I think it's a moral imperative to make sure that we move towards, as noted, housing first. I'm on the board of an organization called Heading Home that has really pioneered this. And it's actually cheaper for us to put somebody in housing first and then also then send the resources, wraparound resources to them. It's good fiscal policy. It's just simply the right thing to do. And that we should be aggressive in this space. For $4 million, we would get 400 vouchers. For $15 million, we would get 1,200 vouchers for people in our community. I want to echo Councilor Baker. I also have to disclose, I actually used to work in the warehouse at the school department. I worked there for a summer. These are hardworking individuals, and they definitely deserve to continue on, as well as the food service workers. And I think as the Boston Public Schools looks at cutting folks who are the people who are doing the work, they should think about cutting people at the top. In the food service program, you have three administrators who make in the six digits. Many of these individuals, Mr. President, make $10,000, $12,000 a year, who are the people who is an additional adult in the school during lunchtime. There's a lot to be said about having adults, in additional adults, who are going to give of themselves in these schools. So I think we should really look at how those cuts are being made and whether or not they're being made at the top tier versus the people who are connecting with our young people and servicing them. And I think there's a lot to continue to do in that space. Thank you so much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Jackson. So I'm going to read each one of these dockets individually. And the chair recommends rejection of docket 0662 without prejudice. Your vote in the... Councilor Jackson, just as I explained. Your vote in the affirmative is to concur with the chair and to reject the budget. Okay? So, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Baker, yes. Councilor Siomo? Councilor Siomo, yes. Councilor Flaherty?
Yes.
Councilor Flaherty, yes. Councilor Jackson?
Yes.
Councilor Jackson, yes. Councilor LaMattina? Councilor LaMattina, yes. Councilor Linehan?
Yes.
Councilor Linehan, yes. Councilor McCarthy?
Yes.
Councilor McCarthy, yes. Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy, yes. Councilor O'Malley? Councilor O'Malley, yes. Councilor Presley? Councilor Presley, yes. Councilor Wu? Councilor Wu, yes. Councilor Yancey?
Yes.
Councilor Yancey, yes. And Councilor Zakim? Councilor Zakim, yes. Mr. President, on docket number 0662, we have a unanimous vote for rejection without prejudice.
A docket 0662, the operating budget for the City of Boston has been rejected without prejudice unanimously.
Docket number 0663, Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Baker, yes. Councilor Siomo?
Yes.
Councilor Siomo, yes. Councilor Flaherty?
Yes.
Councilor Flaherty, yes. Councilor Jackson?
Yes.
Councilor Jackson, yes. Councilor LaMattina? Councilor LaMattina, yes. Councilor Linehan?
Yes.
Councilor Linehan, yes. Councilor McCarthy? Councilor McCarthy, yes. Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy, yes. Councilor O'Malley? Councilor O'Malley, yes. Councilor Presley? Councilor Presley, yes. Councilor Wu? Councilor Wu, yes. Councilor Yancey? Councilor Yancey, yes. And Councilor Zakim? Councilor Zakim, yes. Mr. President, docket number 0663 received a unanimous vote for rejection without prejudice.
Docket 0663 has been rejected without prejudice. It is the operation budget for the school department, and it was rejected unanimously.
Docket number 0664, Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Baker, yes. Councilor Siomo?
Yes.
Councilor Siomo, yes. Councilor Flaherty?
Yes.
Councilor Flaherty, yes. Councilor Jackson?
Yes.
Councilor Jackson, yes. Councilor LaMattina? Councilor LaMattina, yes. Councilor Linehan?
Yes.
Councilor Linehan, yes. Councilor McCarthy?
Yes.
Councilor McCarthy, yes. Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy, yes. Councilor O'Malley? Councilor O'Malley, yes. Councilor Presley? Councilor Presley, yes. Councilor Wu? Councilor Wu, yes. Councilor Yancey? Councilor Yancey, yes. And Councilor Zakim? Councilor Zakim, yes. Mr. President, docket number 0664 received a unanimous vote for rejection without prejudice.
A docket 0664 has been rejected without prejudice unanimously. Madam Clerk, motion, orders, and resolutions, please.
Docket number 1035, Councilor Murphy offered the following order for a hearing regarding concurrent jurisdictions of Massachusetts Port Authority controlled properties located in the City of Boston.
Chair recognizes Councilor Murphy on docket 1035.
Thank you, Mr. President. This actually is a refile from 2010. When the City Council filed a home rule petition on behalf of the citizens of the Seaport District of Boston who live on Massport-owned land. And there's an old Charles Dickens saying that goes way, way back to the 1800s. I think all of Charles Dickens' sayings go back to the 1800s, but this one was, the law is an ass. And in this particular case, the law is an ass. The Massport enabling legislation states that the sole policing authority on all Massport properties shall be the Massachusetts State Police. That means in Boston, if a property is owned by Massport and a big chunk of the Seaport District is on Massport land, State police are the police agency of choice by the state law. So Boston's police department does not have police powers in Boston in that particular, on those particular parcels of land, which creates a hazard in public safety. And I'll just explain one version of it. Which was explained to us 5 years ago and continues to fall on deaf ears with our friends at Beacon Hill. There are several licensed premises over in the Seaport District, all of whom have alcohol licenses by the city of Boston. Under the city of Boston's law, the only people who can enforce alcohol policy are the Boston Police Department. The Massachusetts State Police are prohibited from going into alcohol premises. The Massport Police have no policing authority on a premise that has an alcohol license. So what happens now, and I'm not naming them by names, there's Remy's, Del Frisco's, there's a whole, if you have, I am naming them by names, as I say, I'm not naming them by names. If you have people underage going in there and imbibing, or people being overserved, there's no one checking. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to open the paper someday and see that some 17-year-old girl or 19-year-old boy was killed in a drunk driving accident at 2 o'clock in the morning, leaving the seaport area because we're not doing what we're supposed to do in checking those licensed premises. And that's just one area of public safety. There's a miasma of problems over there. We did a home rule petition. It originated here. It was my name, your name, Mr. President, as the district councilor was on it at the time. Former Mayor Menino signed it. We sent it up there. It didn't pass. It's been sent up there the last two sessions after that. It hasn't passed. It's up there again. It didn't come through here, but it's in the legislature's Joint Committee on Public Safety and Homeland Security. It has a House Bill number, 2107. It was filed by Martin Walsh on behalf of Boston. I'm offering this hearing to jumpstart the education process for our friends on Beacon Hill to let them know that it's 5 years later and we still have a problem with public safety. And concurrent jurisdiction doesn't mean that the Mass State Police lose anything other than their sole designation. They're still full police officers on Massport Police. It just gives our people, our city police department, the same authority in the city of Boston. It's a no-brainer. I hope you'll join me in coming to the hearing, jumpstarting that process to make that part of our city of Boston safer for public safety purposes. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Murphy. Councillor O'Malley?
Thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate Councillor Murphy's Dickensian quote. I will also begin with a quote from Voltaire, who said, "Common sense is not so common." Clearly, this is proof positive of that. This is common sense. This is the city of Boston, the seaport, the South Boston waterfront, whatever you want to call it. It is the, I believe, the fastest growing new neighborhood in the city of Boston. More and more people are living down there. It's part of the city of Boston. I appreciate the chair of public safety's focus on this and have been proudly lent my name for the last couple of years. It's come up a number of times. We need to make this happen. When we had this budget hearing on BPD, we had all asked, and I have said publicly and privately, we'll say so again, that we have the finest police office in any city in the country, if not the world. Time in and time out, day in and day out, we see how well they do their jobs. And this is when we asked them during the budget hearing, what would you like to see going forward? The commissioner brought up this very issue. It is something that the rank and file officers mentioned to all of us. It is simply common sense. We have to make it happen. Thank you to Councilor Murphy for his leadership on this, and I ask that my name be added. Thank you.
Please add the name of Councilor O'Malley. Chair recognizes Councilor and please add the name of Councilor Presley, Wu, Yancey, McCarthy, LaMartina, Flaherty. Please add my name too, Madam Chair. Clerk, and Chair recognizes Councilor Zakim.
Mr. Vice President, I rise to applaud Councilor Murphy in bringing this forward. I don't have any literary quotes as my more learned colleagues over here, but I align myself wholeheartedly with both their remarks. This is Council President Linehan's district, but this is an issue that from news reports, from talking to police officers, from Commissioner Evans, is something that truly is a public safety issue, I think, for all Boston residents and visitors to this city. It makes absolutely no sense that our highly trained, highly regarded police department say, we don't respect and support the work the state police are doing, but our officers are trained in the city of Boston to deal with these issues day to day. I do remember, I believe about a year and a half ago, there was an incident where the state police responded to a crime regarding a livery driver assaulting someone in the area. And because of the the lack of communication, because the BPD did not have jurisdiction there, it took about a week for the Boston police to be aware of this. And this was not the first incident of its kind by that particular individual. So I think in the interest of public safety and coordination of making sure that all of our visitors and residents are safe, we need to make sure that the legislature is aware of our stance on this. Obviously, this hearing is a great step. I think it's I applaud Mayor Walsh as well for continuing to push this at the State House. And I think we need to do what we can to get this through. So please add my name. And thank you, Councilor Murphy, for bringing this forward.
Please add the name of Councilor Zakim. Chair recognizes Council President Linehan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Council Murphy and I have worked on this since 2010, and it's a very important piece of legislation. Just for clarity through the chair, I just want to know, this is a home rule petition?
Yeah.
Okay, that's where the confusion was. So the clarity is that this is not a home rule petition. This is in order for a hearing on a house bill that's up there. Okay, great. So I want to add my voice to this. There's enormous impacts with the fact that Boston police do not have any jurisdiction in certain areas of the Seaport District. And it's pretty widespread. There are four or five different policing agencies down there. And there's a lot of confusion around who has what jurisdiction where. But one thing is clear, that the Boston police do not have jurisdiction on Massport property. And that is wrong. We have people who live there. There are businesses being run there. This is not the airport. That original legislation was put in place to safeguard the airport and have the state police be the sole enforcement at the airport with its unique situation. And then maybe along the port front where there is work that's being done by, stevedores and the tourism industry, okay there, but all the adjacent properties. So it not only has confusion around the liquor license issue, but there has been domestic violence that has occurred in various places that the police have not had the jurisdiction to. When they go in, and they do go in, trust, our police officers still go in, but when it gets to court, they don't have jurisdiction. So if there isn't an accompanying state police officer, then they throw it out. So someone who is a perpetrator could get off on that simple issue. If any of you have been down the Seaport at any time now, you notice that there's an enormous amount of vehicular traffic in and out, and that often traffic is stalled. So here we are, we're building a brand new section of our city, both commercial and residential, as well as tourist industry with the convention center. And then we have the Marine Industrial Park, and we have all of this going on, and there are only so many streets. Well, some of the streets have to be patrolled by Massport police, others by the state police, others by the Boston police. So if we were going to use the Boston police, we were going to use a police force to move traffic in and out of that section due to not additional infrastructure being built, then there's a lack of communication. There's a lack of authority on the part of our own Boston police. So this is truly a mess. It has been brought up a number of times, and we need action. And I applaud the maker for calling us to a hearing so that we can push this agenda forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
And please add my name, of course.
And please add his name. Docket 1035 is assigned to the Committee on Public Safety.
Yeah. Okay. Councilor Jackson.
Mr. President, I do also want to draw our attention to the fact that there's no other place in the city of Boston that Boston police don't actually have jurisdiction. And interestingly, we actually have covenants with other cities, Quincy as well as Dedham, that actually gives Boston Police the opportunity, if they're in a chase, to go a mile and a half into an additional jurisdiction that actually isn't the city of Boston. We need to have concurrent jurisdiction in all aspects of the city of Boston. This is something that should be fixed and fixed immediately. Please add my name.
Please add Councilor Jackson's name. Thank you, Councilor Jackson. And docket 1035 is assigned to the Committee on Public Safety. Oh, and please add Councilor Baker's name, and then place that in the Committee on Public Safety. Madam Clerk, personnel orders, please.
Docket number 1036, Council Linehan for Council
Flaherty. Council Flaherty moves suspension of the rules and passage of docket 1036. All in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1036 is passed.
Docket number 1037, Council Linehan for Council
Flaherty. Flaherty moves suspension of the rules and passage of docket 1036. All in favor say aye. I'm sorry, did you say 37, Madam Clerk?
I thought I said 37.
Yeah, but I didn't repeat that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Councilor Flaherty moves suspension of the rules and passage of docket 1037. All in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1037 has passed.
Docket number 1038, Council Linehan for Councilor O'Malley.
Councilor O'Malley moves suspension of the rules and passage of docket 1038. All in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1038 has passed.
Docket number 1039, Councilor Linehan for Councilor O'Malley.
Councilor O'Malley moves suspension of the rules and passage of docket 1039. All in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. Docket 1039 has passed. I'm informed by the clerk that there are two late file matters, which in absence of objection will be added to the agenda. Hearing no objection, the matters are so added. The clerk will read the first late file matter.
Councilor Bill Linehan for Councilor Yancey.
Councilor Yancey moves suspension of the rules and passage of the first late file matter. All those in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. The first late file matter has passed.
Councilor Bill Linehan for Councilor Yancey.
Councilor Yancey moves suspension of the rules and passage of the second late file matter. All those in favor say aye. All opposed nay. The ayes have it. The second late file matter has passed. Anybody wishing to remove a matter from the green sheets may do so at this time. Councilor Jackson.
Mr. President, I would like to remove on page 1 of 23, 0962.
I'm sorry, what
page number?
1 of 23, the white sheets.
Thank you.
0962, it's in the Committee on Black and Latino Men and Boys.
Madam Clerk, would you please read that?
Thank you, Mr. President. Docket number 0962 in the Committee on Black and Latino Men and Boys, sponsored by Councilor Jackson, resolution that the City Council supports the passage of Senate 64 and House 1429, the Justice Reinvestment Act, filed by State Senator Sonia Chang Diaz and State Representative Mary Keefe, and urges the legislature to enact the reforms therein. It was referred to committee on June 3rd.
Councilor Jackson, you have the floor.
Yes. So in short, there's we killed a lot of trees by printing this out. But in short, this bill does two things. It actually looks at two areas. One, if you're a nonviolent drug offender, your license automatically gets suspended upon you getting arrested and being convicted, which whether or not you were driving or not, your license actually gets suspended. So many of these individuals have a great deal of hardship. That is one of the areas that this covers. It also gives back the mandatory minimum option to the judge. which should happen. There are many individuals who are serving time who are in really difficult situations. The money that is saved by this actually goes into a fund that the city of Boston would benefit from. It would deal with dropout prevention, workforce training and development, and also could be used for youth and summer jobs. So it's a savings in the front end, but then also those savings and that those dollars actually go back to the cities and towns who are affected by this. So the legislation was heard yesterday, is now in joint committee. We are disproportionately affected by matters such as this, and conversations with Steve Tompkins, our sheriff. Many of the individuals who are in his facility are adversely affected by this. And I think the Boston City Council should chime in. And I would ask that we pass this resolution, Mr. President.
Adopt. Thank you, Councilor Jackson. Councilor Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. President. I actually asked to hold this up last week because I hadn't seen the legislation. What is provided is really not telling. It's striking out this, adding this, striking out this. So I asked for a summary of the legislation. In general, the legislation would implement the following: criminal justice reforms, repeal of mandatory minimum for drugs, reduce certain low-level felonies to misdemeanors, allow terminally ill prisoners to be cared for outside of prison, end driver's license suspensions for drug offenses, jobs in schools, creates a trust fund with savings from criminal justice reforms for job training, transitional jobs, and pre-apprenticeship training, youth jobs, job creation, and stay-in-school programs. The following criminal justice reforms are included in the legislation: repeal mandatory minimum drug sentences by restoring judicial discretion in sentencing for nonviolent drug charges, thereby reducing the economic and social cost of extended prison terms; reduce certain low-level felonies to misdemeanors; certain offenses such as shoplifting or petty theft or low-level drug charges would be made misdemeanors with different sanctions that rely less on long and expensive terms of incarceration; end collateral sanctions at the Registry of Motor Vehicles by eliminating the current law that requires the registry to confiscate the license of a person convicted of any drug offense, even where charges are unrelated to the operation of a vehicle, for up to 5 years and a charge of at least $500 to reinstate it; and extraordinary medical placement. This would allow a judge to decide whether a person who is permanently incapacitated or terminally ill should be transferred out of prison for treatment, remaining under state custody. The legislation contains the following provisions related to jobs and schools: the establishment of a trust fund with the cost savings from the improvements to the criminal justice system. Trust funds will be used to direct resources towards programs with broad eligibility, not limited to ex-offenders, that use evidence-based practices to implement job development efforts for youths, veterans, victims of violence, and other people with significant barriers to employment, and help at-risk youth stay in school. Programs supported by the trust will include job training programs to address the skills gaps identified by Massachusetts industry leaders, transitional job and pre-apprentice programs to prepare people for today's workforce and place them in good living wage jobs, youth jobs that provide both sustenance and experience, initiatives to create new jobs through social enterprises, co-ops, and other businesses, and evidence-based programs that specialize in dropout prevention and recovery, giving youth a second chance at academic achievement and setting them on a path to success. So it's a very, very broad, comprehensive criminal justice bill. And the district attorneys of Massachusetts have lined up in opposition to it. It's one of the reasons I didn't run for the legislature, is because I'm here. But it's something that's before us now, and if everybody can can safely say that they support every increment of that, then we should take a vote on it. I'm all about that, but I'm all about knowing and what we're voting for. And that's why I produced this summary. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Murphy. Just a quick recess. Council will be back in session. Councilor Jackson moves adoption of 0962. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay.
Nay.
The ayes have it. 0962 has been adopted. Madam Clerk, any other matters from the green sheets? Anybody? That's good. There are four late file matters which, in absence of objection, will be added to the consent agenda. Seeing, hearing no objections, the matters are so added. The chair moves adoption of the consent agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. The consent agenda is adopted. I would ask all guests and all members to please rise as the council prepares to adjourn today's meeting in memory of the following individuals. Councilor Siomo, Claire Gibbons. For the chair and Councilor Flaherty, Scott Mark Sko-Salmon. For Councilor Baker and Councilor Murphy, John Monahan Jr. For Councilor Murphy and Councilor McCarthy, Helen Donovan, John Donovan's mother at Down in Elections. Councilor O'Malley, Dorothy Romano, Councilor Yancey, Yadelis Delone Camacho. A moment of silence. Thank you. So the chair moves that the council adjourns today, does so in memory of the aforementioned individuals and scheduled to meet on Wednesday, June 17th at 12 noon. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. The council is so adjourned.